requiring funding from both government and private sources. The other is to putting together the technical program. He's a professor at Naval Postgraduate School, honorary California, graduate of Stanford and Rice University, a physicist, and I'm delighted to turn this over to him.
Thank you very much for being here. The program which you have booked and been able to take a look at has all sorts of consolidation of work that's been going on, new experiments, results which start to give us a shot at understanding what this is going on in the field. And the way I structured my guided tour through the program this week is to ask a few questions. So what I'm going to try and do, and I hope that I don't by truncating and cramming into a few number of slides, I hope that I don't offend my friends who've been doing the hard work and brought us to the place where it's worth spending time with each other. See if I can stick it up here. You have this in the front of your program. And the we're in the very first block on Monday. And what I'm going to do is I can very quickly run through what the whole week looks like and sort of tell you why the program looks the way it is. As Dave has said, the Fleischmann-Pons announcement had the result of telling us that there was an unusual amount of heat produced in the protein system. And so, in terms of consolidation of our understanding, one of the things that we did for this conference is we commissioned a series of reviews. And the reviews were twofold. One of them is a friend of mine here in the audience said, we don't need to talk about all the old stuff. But what we do need to do is we need to learn from that old stuff. So the old stuff starts off the morning with a review of what have we learned from the experiments which have been done over the last few years. It's followed then by experiments which are contemporary experiments and results which show that one is, in fact, being able to do something with the Fleischmann. The one problem this field had, and I think it's pretty much resolved, is that the measurement of heat is a 19th century art. Only chemists and people who are looking at how fat the food would make you really worried about it. Calorimetry and high energy part of the business is an important thing. The way they do calorimetry is not the same as what we're talking about here. But measuring how much energy is passing around between systems that are at different temperatures does require skill, a 19th century skill. In the afternoon session, we start off with a discussion of calorimetry dating back to Lavoisier and coming on up to where we are today. The last session of the day is an important session because what this field has been strongly criticized for and legitimately, is that you just can't walk in and turn the key in the ignition and the engine turns over and you get heat. What happens in this field, is, and has happened in every laboratory that's been in operation for any period of time, is that you go in, you do a series of experiments, you get heat, you get very excited, and then it stops. Oh, I bought a new batch of material. So one of the things that I hope we're going to appreciate and understand the progress which is being made today, is that materials are simple. The design of materials is something we can do today at a level of manufacturing, which was not available in 1989. It is an important contribution to this field that we are able to, in fact, imagine designing the kinds of materials which are necessary for the heat effect to be observed. Now, the Fleischmann-Pons original experiments are electrolytic. And the electrolytic experiments are lovely for all sorts of reasons, which electrochemists love dearly. But the one problem with them is that as a practical matter, you still have to break water to get your hands on hydrogen so that then can become available when you put them in the plate. There is another way to do it, and we will have have reports on what has happened in the gas loading systems. We'll have a review, which is also commissioned. And we will also have a report on some recent work with gas loading out of Italy. One of the major players in the development of the use of nanomaterials is our colleague, Professor Arada. And Professor Arada, I think it's fair to say that Professor Arada has a good reputation as an advocate. We are very delighted that two of the younger members of this community are, in fact, giving us the honoring of the session. Dr. Talib Chubb, a longtime friend, scientist, someone who was in the space business in 1948, and Dr. Arada, they're both the same age, they're only 85, have had the interesting thing that they have managed to figure out how to communicate with one another. And we're looking forward to Dr. Chubb's description of Professor Arada's. Another member of our community, who unfortunately is not here, is Stanislav Spock. Dr. Spock has been a long-standing member of the Electrochemical Union, and his contributions are going to be discussed in the next session. We will then move on in the afternoon to particle measurements, and we then have a session which closes out these first 2 days called challenges. The reason the program is organized in this fashion is that we have invited a fair number of people who have not been in the field or who have been away from the field for some considerable period of time. It is our hope that by spending 2 days here that they will have been given an opportunity to understand something that we have learned over this period of time. Now, as a friend of mine jokingly put it, he says it's not bad for those of us who have been paying attention to understand what all of us have. So we hope that it will also serve a useful purpose for those who are working in the field. The rest of the week tends to be a good deal more technical, and the only thing I'm going to point out right now is that we have country histories. And country histories are an assembling by each of the researchers in the various countries, the 8 countries which are the dominant research countries in this field. And these histories are written in the languages of We will have 6 of those discussed on Wednesday, and next year those will be produced in volume, a series of volumes in English. We have an international editorial board of people who are not in the field who will be producing a set of volumes for the 20th anniversary. The rest of the week, theory will mostly 2 sessions. We have a convergence of interest with experiments, scattering experiments. I never thought I would see scattering experiments showing up here, but we're honored to have people who are in that business working diligently with us to try and understand the mechanisms. And again, materials are all important. So we have another material session. And then we'll wrap things up with some more reports on Friday morning. And then there will be a summary in the last part of the session. So, I'm going to put up a few questions. I'm going to flip through these quickly. I don't expect you to read these right now. I'm going to go one by one. Is there unexplained entropy, excess entropy? And what we have in this meeting are the review by Cravens and Less, 167 papers examined for what we have learned. Mitchell Schwartz, Dr. Schwartz, will report on some of the experiments which he has done, which you've seen in the preview of. Slides, and our colleagues from Israel, Shaul Lessen, will be presenting on ways in which one, in fact, improves the ability to produce excess heat in the system. The afternoon session, as I mentioned, is how good are our measurements of excess entropy? And in this poster sessions, and I don't want to make you think that the only thing that's happening is what's going on in this general plenary. Because there are many very interesting papers. I would want to point out, I'm co-author on a paper, and I'm in the poster session. I hope you'll come and visit. There have been improvements over our 1995 understanding that if you look at the loading levels, the average load levels, the deuterium and the plating, if you look at the current flux, if you look at the flux of deuterium now, those were clearly parameters important to producing excess heat. What we have learned, and I think it's increasingly obvious, is that if you have no control or limited control of the materials you're making your system power, cathodes and carbon, we're talking about this, is that you have a very, very much random chance of actually producing heat. Some things seem to correlate nicely, and I hope there will be some understanding of the correlations that we are now starting to see showing up as we improve the instrumentation and the experimental techniques which we use. In the Arata session, I don't think I need to say more about that. In the Spock session, the one thing that's remarkable about the Spock group is that they have, from the very beginning, decided they wanted 3 months to get results. And they designed an experiment which, within a few days, immediately starts doing something interesting. And they have explored that. They have, as Frank Gordon is quick to point out, we are doing experiments which get published in papers that are in review journals. We do experiments which teach you things. They're experiments that it's even possible for people to learn about and to do. You know, this is beginning to look an awful lot like science, as a comment to make, is a bit from nature. So, we have got an opportunity to learn from this within tomorrow afternoon. The one thing that comes out of both the Arata and Spock experimental systems is we've learned the importance of control. In the semiconductor business, controlling contamination levels is long enough to have a great effect upon whether or not you will successfully produce integrated circuits. We don't know whether it's dirt in the system which helps, or particular dirt which helps, particular dirt which hurts. And the ability to do experiments in a factorial way is something which the cost of the original experiments did not really prevent. We've also learned that you turn this system on by making it go into some non-equilibrium state. That's called trigger. Now, we have a session, which I hope that Andre Lipson will be able to make from Moscow to kick off, because this is really the nuclear physicist crew looking at what's going on. Andre has a paper, which I think is very important, and he will give it some. I'm not going to preempt it by telling you what he's saying, but it's a very important result, because again, it gets back to control. We have another set of experiments from the Key Lab folks talking about what you get out of the system other than people. We'll have John Fisher talking about the work that Richard Oriani has done. Richard, unfortunately, won't be with us this week. And again, Larry Forsley and Pam Mosher-Boss from the Spock Consortium are going to talk about their experience with doing CR39 detection. Now, on the challenges session, the senior member of the International Advisory Committee for this meeting, Mike McCoubery, will talk about if you're really going to ever do anything with this, either in terms of exploring the science or building anything, you need to have control at least of non-logical. I'd like to point out, however, that high signal noise is all that is needed to determine that there is something there. We're not in the high signal noise business any longer. We're in the business of actually trying to understand it, which does mean that we need to make many of them. Towards that, there is a need for being able to detect very low fluences of charged particles, because these systems don't produce the normal signatures that you would find in normal vacuum scattering experiments with deuterons and deuterons. So we have a nice report from Professor Kasagi's group on how you, in fact, are able to detect the energy and identify the particles that are done in the Iwamura style experiments or any of the gas combination experiments. Now, one of the arguments in the community that I think it's important to to understand that when you are dealing with very, very small quantities of materials embedded in a matrix of plate, in other words, if I'm looking for a 100 billionth of a gram of material in a 7 gram sample, that's a pretty good needle in a haystack. And what you really want to be able to do is that if you do find something, and you find it not before and not after, you'd like to know where it came from. So one of the important pieces of work with respect to analytical techniques will be given by David Kidwell, who has had wide experience in doing trace element analysis, and I will find it interesting to see your reaction, because what Dave has pointed out is that finding a needle in a haystack, annoying a needle, does take a lot more work than I'm afraid we ever appreciate. Now, from the very beginning, Mel Miles and Ben Bush at Channel 8 correlated the heat produced in their electrochemical system with the presence of heat. Our friend Andre Lipson says, you know, that heat stuff is really nice, but I'm not sure it's nuclear. Andre says, you know, alpha particles are not the same as heat in essence. Alpha particles with a few MeV of energy, or as his experiments, 10 to 20 MeV of energy, are not the same as heat. I'm a net nuclear guy, I'm a scattering guy, I'm looking for the 10 or 20 MeV part of it. And maybe there is a connection, and that heat stuff is really curious. And Andre, when he gets here, will be happy to have this argument with you. And whether or not he's getting closer to saying it might be possible that the amount of heat we observe is, in fact, associated directly with the heat. It's still a bit of an open scientific question, but it's a practical question, so it doesn't matter. There are also other systems which are producing heat. Mizuno, and I picked Mizuno's work, but there are a couple of others, and I apologize to the authors, I didn't include everything. And the basic question in all of these systems, I've done a very good experiment, I know what I put in the experiment, I know what was there at the end, I burned everything up, and I measured the amount of heat, and it comes out much too big. In Mizuno's report, he's going to detect that he's seen some gamma rays in the system, which is not the usual product of people in most chemical systems. And of course, our friend Mitchell, again, will be talking about some experiments he's done this year, where he is showing the production of near-infrared light associated with the production of heat. We have a branch of the business which deals with transmutation, changing one element to another element, or to different isotopes. Iwamura, I believe, will have an opportunity to offer another string of presentations in which he shows results from the light source at Spring 8. Dash, Tomova, and others continue a progression of presentations. And then on Friday afternoon, George Miley has organized a session. All are invited to sign up for that session. It deals with transmutation. This is an interesting question for me because we have in this region where we're doing things below 10 MeV, where the particles come together, the energies below 10 MeV, the nuclear physics guys have been starting to see the global environment and solar makes an important difference. And the effects are sufficiently important in natural physics, which got this started, that the way in which the nuclei came into existence and how we do the atomic paper is dependent on this process. Is there any connection to excess heat? Professor Fukai says, of course not. After all, EVs and MEVs are too far apart. How do you get them together? It also is interesting that if this work does connect up, we will be in good shape to look inside. Okay, what is the future? I'm not even going to try and argue the theories here. I hope that you will listen to our sessions on theories. And there's a question that they've left you with. Are there applications on the horizon, or is this going to be a scientific theory? We have natural histories of cold fusion. I've discussed these. Now, personally, I started paying attention to this in April of 1989. And that's a fair question to ask each of us who've been involved in the beginning. I think we all are fascinated by the prospect of something important. The Edisonian nature of what has to occur is a reflection of our real inability to know what of the various things we can imagine doing. We're interested largely because of these kinds of numbers. It's too big for chemistry, and it doesn't look like the nuclear. We know that that could be all sorts of places. So let me tell you that as the chairman of the program committee, and as the researchers who will be reporting this week, this is a mind-stretching operation, and we think it is a great potential.